concerning the way. What is required of Rastafari? What is expected of us as Rastafari? The book of Joshua, chapter 1, verse 8. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then shalt thou make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Let us go on forward to Book of Joshua, chapter 3, verse 4. Yet there shall be a space between you and it. And this is speaking concerning the ark, us and the ark. Well, okay, let us begin with verse 3, chapter 3 of the book of Joshua. And they commanded the people, saying, when ye see the ark of the covenant of the Lord your God, and the priest, the Levites, bearing it, then ye shall remove from your place and go after it. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, about 2,000 cubits by measure. Come not near to it, that ye may know the way by which ye must go. For ye have not passed this way hither heretofore. So, when we see the Ark of the Covenant, we are to go after it. And there shall be a space of approximately 2,000 cubits by measure. You know, some of us have been waiting 2,000 years for this way to be made manifest to us, that we may pursue after it. But more importantly, that we may know the way by which we must go, because we have not passed or been on this way before. So, you know, in a sense, let us not get ahead of ourselves, lest we, you know, go ahead of the ark, and you know, that is death. Let's not get carried away. There must be some space between us and the Ark of the Covenant, that we may follow the exemplary life of Jesus Christos. You know, so basically, throughout this reasoning, we intend to go over some verses that instruct us in the way that we are to walk. Being that we oftentimes have questions as to how to contribute, how we can help, what it is that we have to do, what's required of us. But first and foremost, we will not be able to fulfill that if we do not meditate on this book here day and night. You know, we'll give one example. Oftentimes we are instructed to fear the Lord our God, and when it is said fear, it is in the sense of reverence, to respect and to obey, and to do the things that are written by him, or, you know, spoken by him and written, you know, through human hands, nonetheless inspired in spirit of truth. Thus, we must know what exactly to reverence or to fear the Lord our God is. And in order to do that, we must know scripture. It is the foundation, the basis. If we do not, you know, do our best to study the Bible as much as possible, then anything else will be useless. We must become familiar and you know, well, we must be one with the Bible and truth. If possible, memorize as much as possible, and but don't, you know, don't make that your goal. That'll just happen, you know. Just that is honestly, that is the most important thing that we could possibly make mention of. Read scripture, read and learn for yourself, and then again, you know, don't get ahead of yourselves. Let us even die, not get ahead of ourselves, and just take it a step at a time. You know, there must be space between us and the ark that we may know by which way we must go. So once again, if we are Rastafari, what can we do? Read our Bibles, honestly. And from there, you'll get all the answers. That is for sure. That we promise. So now let us go forward to let us make mention, you know, just a side note. That word way, it's actually the Hebrew 1870, the H1870. The word is Ibraist, is derek. It's described as a going, a journey. But even more interesting, it gives us a route that leads to the Ge'ez. You know, the Blue Letter Bible Study Dictionary presents the word derek as the Ibraist, and then it has a Amharic root, and it's in fact the Ge'ez. And it also gives us Phanos, which is Phanos is the Amareña, the Amharic for lamp, for light, like an oil lamp. And Ge'ez, it's a form of worshiping. It is a way of living. It is a manner in which we emulate a certain life. It's exactly what it is, you know, as we were instructed, you know. And every man upon this earth must do their maximum effort in thus to manifest and see to it that we emulate the exemplary life that has been set by him, by Jesus Christos. And so we as Rastafari in spirit were not incorrect. Our elders were right on the money, they would say, you know, but they were 100% correct when they, you know, passed on to us that Rastafari is a way of life, a way to conduct ourselves in a manner of which we have been taught to do so in the Bible. The thing is, even though that is true in spirit, it will not fulfill truth, because if we do not read our Bibles as much as possible, we will not know the instruction as how to behave ourselves upon this pilgrimage experience, so on and so forth. And also, Ge'ez is a religion. The way of life is, the light is a religion. We must accept that. You know, we may not like it, but nonetheless, other peoples throughout this world identified to religion as that word necessary in order to respect your way of life, then so be it, you know. If we happen to overstand certain matters to a higher degree, so be it. But we must, you know, when it comes to us having to deal with the earthly, then we speak to them earthly things, you know. So go forward onto the book of the prophet Micah. And it'll be chapter 6. Book of the prophet Micah, chapter 6, verse 8. And it reads, "He hath shewed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee, but to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God." You know, so not a single verse that we present to the eye this day today will actually answer the question of what is expected of us, but at least it will point out certain keywords that we can individually go about and look further into, that we may know the fullness of these requirements. So, you know, right from the start, we have a few requirements of how to be good. We've been taught, "O man, O men, I and I, how to be good, and we have a few requirements here: to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly. So we can use this and go forward and better understand what it even means to be humble, to be merciful, and to do justly, you know? So let us go forward to Hosea chapter 12. It's going to be Hosea chapter 12, verse 6. And it reads here, therefore, turn thou to thy God, lean, tend, you know, incline oneself to the bosom, to the heart of God of hosts. Oh, my bad. Therefore, lean, you know, incline yourself to thy God. You know, keep mercy. Once again, mercy and judgment. Let's find out what mercy and judgment, you know, in their fullness, actually signify. And wait on thy God continually. This one is extremely important. To wait, we must look for him, we must seek, you know, the Bible and him that inspired within human individuals to write his thoughts for later reference, we could say. He oftentimes points out that he is amongst us, to look for him. We must not take the name of our Lord God in vain. You see, much of the world wants to believe that what they accept is accepted in truth. But then if one presents the idea that God is amongst us, it's like, no. That's not what we believe. I mean, we believe it, but just make believe, you know, just imaginary. It doesn't mean that, or we don't mean it in the sense that he's actually here. You know, you just pretend that he's here. That is erroneous. You know, we Rastafari, we are not to be as such, you know, over and over and over. It is written, you know, I'm amongst you, I'm here, I'm there, I do this, you know. We must wait continually, always, expect them always, wherever we're at, you know, they will be there, Father, Son, in the Holy Spirit. This isn't no joke, all right, this isn't make pretend, this is what it is, but there's no way that I can make it so that ones can receive it. Ones have to actually go into the study themselves and allow themselves to have that Holy Spirit bestowed upon them, you know. And so it's like when we're not sure if ones could relate to this, but it's like when you know, as children, even as young adults or whatever age the situation happened to happen at to each individual, you know, if like when we're being taught something and we do understand, really, like we get it, we did understand the instructions and how to go about that which was explained to us. But then when we actually go and do it for ourselves, it's like, whoa, you know, even if you don't tell anyone, but there's a self-satisfaction within yourself that you completed the task on your own. Even like when, for this is, I think this is a better example, like when you're in school and you know, you have a few questions that you have to do, and you go to the back of the book and you get the questions right, and you know, you finish your assignment, turn it in, like, yeah, you go play with your friends and stuff like that, but those few times that you actually found the answer without looking at the, without cheating, basically, you know, if there may be exceptions to this rule, but for sure most of us felt something within ourselves, you know, kind of like just a moment of in a sense being proud, you know, of oneself, because the satisfaction was not that we turned in the homework or that we're going to get the credit, but rather that we know that we completed the task and did the best that was the best possible within us, you know, and on our own. And it just, you know, before we get sidetracked and stuff like that, we just want to make mention how that feeling that you get, that I answered that question without having anyone tell me the answer, without copying, without cheating and stuff like that. And you know, there's something there. Well, it's the same with the word of truth and receiving the Holy Spirit. One must go through that same process. You know, you can't expect, well, you can, but it won't benefit one so much. For instance, I would rather one, instead of watching the videos and stuff like that, just go to the scripture, and you will get that same feeling, except now it'll be something far beyond that which we have ever experienced and could ever explain. You know, the love of Christ cannot be found through a series of questions and answers, and a man's soul cannot receive greater enrichment as a result. So this is something that ones have to take up for themselves and take the time to actually do it. So now let us go forward to Hosea. The whole reason we went into that was, let us not forget that God is real, you know, and he is amongst us. Let's not pretend that that's make-believe, you know. We even saw this presentation of a so-called rabbi, you know, well-respected and stuff like that, that was arguing that nowhere in the Bible, even in the Torah, that nowhere in the Torah that it is said that that God is going to be a man, you know. When you know, that's how bad things are. A rabbi saying that, that's pretty bad. You know, it's written like verse after verse, and I will walk among you, I will be among you, and stuff like that. So you know, we got to be careful. So now let us go on forth to Hosea chapter 6, verse 6, and it reads, "For I desired mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings." Mercy. Now we get something different, the knowledge of God. We must, you know, we must do diligence to study and show ourselves approved to God. You know, as workmen need not be ashamed, rightfully dividing the word of truth. And, you know, by knowing we shall be set free, and whom the Son has freed is free indeed. We must know. We must know. So let us go on forward to actually Isaiah chapter 1. Verse 17, and it reads, "Learn to do well." So learn. What is well? We must learn. "Seek judgment." Let us seek. This verse right here is actually perfect, because it tells us what we have to do and how to attain it. How can we do well? We must learn. Learn thyself. Know thyself. We're instructed to have judgment, bring judgment. And how to go about it? Seek it. Look for it. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. You know, come now. Let us reason together. This is very important. We must be the voice and declare the justice due the people whom justice is due. There's a lot of fatherless children who have no fathers to speak for them. We must be that voice. There's a lot of widows who have no man, no head to defend them. We must be their head. There's a lot of oppressed, downpressed that have no relief. We must be their relief. We must be as His Majesty, the Ras, the head, the conscience of this world. You know, we must constantly, in diligence, remind the world of what is needful to be reminded of, and, you know, bring judgment, do well, relieve the downpressed, judge the fatherless, and plead for the widows, you know, because a lot of these people throughout the world have no one to speak for them. And it, you know, if you, well, let us not go into what we were almost going into, but nonetheless, let us rather let us go forward to 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22. And Samuel said, "Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying?" I kind of got lost. "As in obeying the voice of the Lord?" Question. "Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams." So, better than sacrifices is to obey, and to hearken, to listen, and to listen in two different ways, right? But how can we obey and hearken if we don't even know that voice? You know, those that don't recognize the voice of their shepherd is because they have not read. You know, how can ones really get the fact that Jesus Christos, or we as Rastafari, are speaking the words of our Father if if you've never read? You're left to just, you know, self vain imagination. But ones who have read and they listen to Rastafari in spirit and in truth, one learnt, then they'll know he's speaking the truth, because that's all in the Bible. You see, that is our strength, our power. We personally have been in many situations where people want to, you know, contend our sayings, but the ones that have read and are somewhat familiar with the scriptures, they just stay quiet. Some of them get really upset. Some, you know, some are furious. Some, you know, there's gnashing of teeth in some cases. Some are just in awe. Some can't explain themselves how one is saying the things that we're saying. But nonetheless, the key focus here is that those that have read, they know. They can't say anything. They just rather either stay quiet, or sometimes we even get responses as, "That's true, that's right, man, yeah, mm-hmm," you know. Even if they may not agree or whatever they wish to do with what they have received, it's up to them. But nonetheless, we just want to point out the fact that they heard a voice that they recognized, and so that is our strength, because those that know can receive where the inspiration is coming from. So, you know, we must obey and hearken. And how can we do such things if we're not familiar and well, you know, can recognize what is of our shepherd and even of our Father? So now let us go forward to Deuteronomy chapter 10, and verse 12 and verse 13. "And now, Israel, what doth the Lord thy God require of thee?" Rastafari hoy, what is required of thee? "But to fear the Lord thy God, to walk in all his ways, and to love him, and to serve the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul, to keep the commandments of the Lord and his statutes, which I command thee this day for thy good," for our good. Our chastisement is for our good. You know, we put up with some, you know, with some beatings from parents for you know, personal reasons. How much more are we to put up with godly beatings that are for our good and benefit, you know? And Another thing is, you know, Jesus Christos, he commanded us to keep the words, the commandments. And whomsoever keepeth the commandments, you know, loveth him, and shall be loved of the Father. His Imperial Majesty said the same thing. Now let us bring forth, this is kind of like off topic, but it has to do with what we were instructed of by His Imperial Majesty. And this is concerning who is an Ethiopian, who is a real Ethiopian. If we want to, you know, define Ethiopians as burnt faces, Moses had a burnt face when he came face to face with the Lord our God, and his face was illuminated with truth to the extent that our fathers were not able to stand in the presence of Moses. So they did the same thing as they did with the Lord our God. They put a veil upon him so that they would be blind of these things, you know, which explains why the hearts of many are blind to this, because many don't want to see. They don't want to see. Sometimes we're walking and people just do not want to see us because they become burnt with such illumination. You know, we speak and heads begin to hurt. We speak and people begin to tremble in their you know, weak, unstable foundations. You know, our words are brighter than the sun. The sun can only shine in the parts of the earth in which it is facing. So during the night, the sun cannot illuminate. During the day, the moon does not illuminate. But our truth, it blinds people to the point where they do not even want to see, be it day, be it night. You know, so that is that. Well, we kind of went off topic once more, but keeping to what we were trying to, you know, just show how Rastafari are burnt faces, the illuminated ones, the ones who have seen the light. And so keeping to this is who is a real Ethiopian. We say Rastafari, His Imperial Majesty, he goes on to answer Dr. Oswald, or Mr. Oswald, in the Lutheran Christmas special interview. Oswald makes mention the question, what advice do you have for the younger generations, or, you know, for the youth then? And His Majesty says, to all of those that to whom I am emperor, to all those to whom I am emperor. And he makes sure that he makes known to the world that in this case he's not only talking about his immediate empire Ethiopia, because he knew what was to come. And so he makes mention, you know, in this particular case, I would like to, you know, make sure that everyone knows that I'm not just speaking about Ethiopians here right now. This goes for anyone, to whomever I am emperor, if they keep and do the commandments, as that is also what I keep and do, then I would accept that our empire, Ethiopian empire, is not only historically Christian but actively Christian. So, you know, that who are Ethiopians? Those that to whom he is emperor. And to whom is he emperor? To them whom keep his commandments. You know, it's no coincidence that that we've been rooted out of a land and brought to another in order to cut us off from that which was filthy anyways. Not saying that we are any better, but nonetheless, you know, we've had grace bestowed upon us. So, you know, if that be what it be, then, you know, that's the decision of His Majesty, and we give thanks to be a part of the elect few. But so it's no hard feelings, you know, to anyone else, in all sincerity. But anyways there is a reason why we were cut off from the motherland and you know, dispersed throughout the world. It was His Majesty, is it, you know, he led his soldiers to battle. his army to battle. He's well learned in strategies and in the military tactics. This was a well and carefully planned strategy and well executed. We got to keep that in mind. You know, kind of like this is completely going off track, but nonetheless, we've begun, so let us complete. If we go to Deuteronomy real quick, excuse me for this, it oftentimes happens, but we have a problem keeping our focus like well centered, and we got to work on that. Deuteronomy chapter 29 verse 29, the secret things belong. Oh no, my bad. Let us begin from verse 28. Verse 27 goes on to say that, you know, and when it come to pass that y'all receive the curses and the blessings, you know, since Deuteronomy, it was expected that this would come about. So now verse 28 of chapter 29 of the book of Deuteronomy, it reads, and the Lord rooted them out of their land in anger and in wrath and in great indignation, and cast them into another land, as it is this day. Verse 29, the secret things belong to the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. So once again, the instruction to whom it has been revealed, to those same whom he is emperor, and to whom is he emperor? To those that keep all the words of this law. You know, now actually let us with that, let us even include something else just to show the wisdom to those that can receive it. This is small booklet, The Wise Mind of Emperor Haile Selassie I. Now let's see how quickly we can go about to find that which we are looking for, but it's a quote, and it just shows the Almighty, you know, thinking of all things at all times, that his will might be done and not the will of vain imaginist. Now okay, we're actually now, this is under the topic of unity and brotherhood, fairly enough. It is a sound tactic of military strategy to attack where your opponent's defense is weakest. It is surely sound strategy for all of us to move ahead where such movement is unobstructed and unimpeded. You know, this is all sound strategy. A tactic is only a minor plan within a bigger picture, but a strategy is the big picture. You know, Elohim, the creation spirit, knowing what was to come about within the Imperial Ethiopian, faithful Ethiopian Empire kingdom. Since long ago, this has been taken care of. You know, that is why we find ourselves in the places that we find ourselves, so that such obstruction, so that our movement is not obstructed or impeded. You know, this is just brilliant strategic warfare, you know, on the part of the Almighty. So yeah, we can't recall how it is that we even got to that, but let us conclude with Genesis. That was completely something else, but Genesis chapter 18, we'll conclude with that. 18 verse 19 it'll be. That's interesting. Okay, so it reads here, for I know him that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord, to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him. Shalom Rastafari.